The Great Leap was not one of fire or wheel, but of light. It began with a whisper, a silent digital pulse racing through copper and glass. The internet, humanity's grand nervous system, was born. For the first time, a thought in Jakarta could find a home in Juneau in the blink of an eye. At first, the internet arrived like a miracle. It was hailed as the great equalizer, a network where any human voice could, in theory, reach all others. For the first time in recorded history, the barrier between ruler and ruled, rich and poor, was pierced by an invisible web of electrons. Knowledge that had once been sequestered in libraries, universities, and the gilded halls of power, now coursed through fiber optic veins and filled the screens of anyone with a connection. The people rejoiced. The ruling elite, the ancient and interwoven dynasties of capital and power, watched with initial disdain, then mounting alarm. Their hegemony, perfected over millennia, was a simple, brutal algorithm. Control information, control labor. Control labor, control wealth. The peasant who cannot read is a serf. The factory worker who cannot unionize is a cog. The populace that sees only the world presented to it is a herd. The internet threatened to shatter this foundational control. Whistleblowers could speak. The exploited could organize. The manipulated could compare notes. The sheer chaotic velocity of truth was an existential threat. The poor toiled because they believed the system immutable. They obeyed because they did not know the machinery of exploitation that governed them. The internet threatened to reveal too much, too quickly. And so, a new plan was drafted in boardrooms and secure government facilities. It was not a plan of blunt force, of stormtroopers and book burnings. That was for barbarians and a bygone era. This was a plan of exquisite, insidious precision. Its genius lay in its gradualness. They understood the parable of the boiling frog. They would not toss humanity into a pot of raging fire, but would lower it into cool water and turn up the heat, degree by imperceptible degree. Phase one was convenience. It began with a single search bar. Google promised to organize the world's information, and humanity, overwhelmed by the digital deluge, gratefully accepted. Soon, one could not write a report, find a fact, or perform a job without it. The tool became a prosthesis for the mind. Then came social media, a carnival of connection that quietly trained its users to surrender their personal lives, their relationships, their likes and fears, in exchange for a hit of dopamine. The water was warm and pleasant. Students, workers, even small entrepreneurs could do in minutes what once took days. Yet, with each search, the dependency deepened. People began to realize they could no longer function without the machine's index of knowledge. Soon, the machine was not just a helper, it was the gatekeeper. Phase two was identification. The argument was seductive. Security from terrorists, convenience from fraud, a key to a seamless digital society. The concept of a digital ID was introduced not as a chain, but as a key. It began with single sign-ons for email and shopping. It matured into national biometric systems linked to everything. Your face was your passport, your thumbprint, your bank card. To be offline was to be invisible, to be a non-person. The fence was being built, one digital post at a time. First voluntary, then required for banking, travel, work, even access to healthcare. They soon became as indispensable as food or water. A human without a digital ID ceased to exist in the official world. Phase 3 was consolidation. The data centers began to rise, monolithic temples to a new god called AI. The public was told they were for machine learning, for generating art, for driving cars, for medical miracles. And they were. But their primary function, their immense, humming computational power, was for pattern recognition on a scale Orwell's Oceania could never muster. Every search query, every private message, every purchase, every step tracked by a phone was funneled into these centers. They were not just learning language, they were learning people. Predicting dissent, mapping social networks, identifying thought criminals before the thought was fully formed. At first, the data was said to power conveniences, targeted ads, safer streets, personalized medicine. There, we are in truth. But behind the veil, vast data centers, ostensibly for artificial intelligence, were constructed as engines of pattern recognition, machines of mass inference, capable of predicting not only what a person would buy, but what they would believe, what they would resist, and when they might rebel. Orwell had written of crude telescreens and ministries of truth. He could never have imagined this precision. Information, once sprawling and chaotic, was drawn into curated platforms. What began as a war on misinformation became a purge of dissent. Books ceased to be printed, archives quietly altered, history rewritten in subtle increments. Soon, knowledge itself became a subscription service, filtered through centralized algorithms. By the time services like ChatGPT arrived, people no longer saw them as tools. They were lifelines. And yet, all responses, all truths, all histories flowed from a single, ever-pruned source. The multiplicity of human voices that had once erupted on the early internet was reduced to a managed chorus. The final piece was the central source of truth. It began with fact-checking. A noble idea weaponized. Alternative viewpoints were first branded misinformation, then malinformation, then thought crime. Historical archives were updated for clarity. The internet, once a vast wilderness of truth and lies, was pruned into a beautiful manicured garden. Only one narrative was allowed to grow. Now, the water is near boiling. The worker of today does not consult a library or a colleague. They prompt the ministry's approved large language model, the direct descendant of ChatGPT. It provides the answer, clean, sourced, and perfect. It is the only source, for all others have long since vanished down the memory hole. It provides the allowed truth for the report, the allowed argument for the debate, the allowed history for the student. To question its output is not to be wrong. It is to be insane, to reject reality itself. The populace is peaceful, content, and utterly dependent. They believe they are free because they can choose any brand of soda, any entertainment stream. They do not see the virtual fences because they have never tried to jump them. Their world is safe, curated, and sterile. George Orwell imagined a boot stamping on a human face forever. He was a visionary, but he could not foresee the subtlety of the coming cage. He imagined telescreens that watched with a single, unblinking eye. He did not foresee the billions of eyes we would willingly carry in our pockets, the microphones we would activate ourselves, the digital identities we would cling to, as proof of existence. The rulers had achieved what their ancestors could only dream of, a total information state, not through brute force, but through dependency. And the people, lulled by convenience and anesthetized by the pace of incremental change, sat idly by as the fences closed. Thus, humanity entered a new age, one not of liberation, but of elegant servitude. The chains were invisible, the cage digital, the master faceless. And unlike the empires of the past, which rose and fell with the tides of history, this machine promised no end. For as long as the data centers hummed, as long as the algorithms refined, the truth itself would belong to those who ruled. The enslavement is not of chains and whips, but of accepted limitations. It is not a prison of steel, but of the mind. The control system is not maintained by fear of the Gestapo, but by dependence on a system too convenient, too essential, to live without. And as the data centers hum, learning, adjusting, and perfecting their model of humanity, the elite know their victory is complete. They have not just won the present, they have architectured the past and future, ensuring their quiet, prosperous dominion for 1,000 years to come. The frog feels no urge to jump. The water is so very, very warm. And while this narrative is largely speculative, it is grounded in scholarship and critical thinking. The evidence is all around us. If you like this video, please hit the subscribe button, and thank you for watching.